This episode of Real Science is brought to you by CuriosityStream. Sign up today at curiositystream.com/realscience and get free access to watchnebula.com. Most of us probably think of malaria as a disease confined to the tropics. It thrives in Southeast Asia, the Eastern Mediterranean, parts of Central and South America, and Africa, which carries most of the global malaria burden. And when we think of malaria, we probably think of humid jungles or tropical lakes in equatorial regions. As of 2017, 87 countries had ongoing malaria transmission, with places like the US and Europe appearing to be safely off the list. It's easy to assume that's because the US and Europe are not tropical places, but in fact, both places used to be riddled with malaria. In the US in particular, it debilitated towns, caused thousands of deaths, and even determined the settlement patterns of the country. But now, it has been so thoroughly erased that many people don't even know it used to exist there at all. So how is it that malaria once thrived in the US, and why did it disappear? And perhaps most importantly, can the methods of its elimination in the US be copied elsewhere? To understand the spread of malaria in the US, it's important to consider the life cycle and behavior of the Plasmodium parasite and its vector, the mosquito. Malarial parasites are carried by the Anopheles mosquito, which breeds in still water, such as marshy ponds and swamps, features that exist in great numbers in the eastern and southern United States. When a mosquito bites an infected person, a small amount of blood is taken in, which contains microscopic malaria parasites, which then mate in the gut of the mosquito and begin a cycle of growth and multiplication. About 1 week later, a form of the parasite called a sporozoite migrates to the mosquito's salivary glands. When the mosquito takes its next blood meal, these parasites mix with the mosquito's saliva and are injected into the next person being bitten. The sporozoite then rides in the bloodstream towards the human liver. Once it arrives, it enters a liver cell. There, it undergoes many rounds of division and multiplication. A single infected liver cell can lead to the creation of thousands of new parasites. These new parasites then migrate to infect red blood cells, where they can hide from the body's immune system. Here, they consume the contents of the red blood cell and divide to create even more parasites. Eventually, the red blood cell they are inhabiting ruptures, and the new parasites called merozoites are released. These continue the cycle by invading other red blood cells, which subsequently also rupture. The parasites living in the bloodstream is what causes the symptoms of malaria, which can range from headaches to fever to seizures to death if the parasites block arteries in the brain and kidneys. At this point, the parasite within the human bloodstream can then be ingested once again by a mosquito and transmitted to another unsuspecting human, and the cycle begins again. No one knows for sure when malaria was first introduced into humans, but it is thought to have been in prehistoric times. But as for the US, its infestation with the disease was not brought about until the 17th century, with the first arrival of slave ships from Africa. Once the parasite was introduced to North American shores, places like the wet, low-lying plains of Virginia and South Carolina became overrun with the disease. The Carolinas were initially thought of as a land of paradise by European settlers, but with the introduction of malaria, became known as a ghastly place to live. An English proverb at the time said, "Those who want to die quickly, go to Carolina." Incoming immigrants thus labeled certain colonies as healthy and others as dangerous. The Caribbean was understood to be the most dangerous, with Florida and the Carolinas being a close second. The Chesapeake was a bit better, but only in the northern colonies, New York, New England, and Pennsylvania, did European settlers thrive. And because most African slaves had some tolerance to malaria, and white indentured laborers from Europe did not, demand for slave labor in malarious areas also increased. Malaria, along with other diseases like yellow fever, thus had a substantial role in determining settlement and labor patterns in the colonies, patterns that would eventually lead to the Civil War. Malaria wreaked havoc in America for centuries, and by the time of the First World War, malaria was a huge problem, especially for the military, where men training in the South were picking up the disease in rapid numbers. 10,500 admissions for malaria were reported from April 1917 through December 1919, involving a loss of 130,000 training days. By the 1930s, malaria had become concentrated in 13 of the country's southeastern states, and there were well over a million cases during the Great Depression. Malaria had become a major national problem. By 1933, malaria deaths in America reached a new peak. Malaria thrives when poverty is high, where people lack access to adequate healthcare and nutrition, and America had just descended into the Great Depression. But for the next decade, where malaria should have boomed, it instead retreated. But the exact reason why isn't as clear as you might think. To this day, scientists and historians fiercely argue about which of the many factors was the key to its eradication. At the time, there were two camps of opinion on the best way to get rid of malaria. The first, to attack the parasite inside the human body. The second, to eliminate the vector for the disease, the mosquito. If it were possible to treat all members of a community at once and eradicate the parasite within them, then malaria could be wiped out, even if the adult mosquitoes carry on biting everyone. For hundreds of years, people were aware that quinine, obtained from cinchona bark, could be used to alleviate the symptoms of and even prevent malaria. So, in 1916, scientists carried out a study on 500,000 people in Bolivar County, Mississippi, a place plagued with malaria, to see if quinine could be used as an effective treatment. They gave out doses of quinine for free, and indeed found that it reduced malaria infections by 90%. However, even though high doses of quinine were good for quickly ending an episode of fever and chills, they found that people would not take enough quinine on a regular basis to prevent infection long term because of its bad side effects. Therefore, it was useful for interrupting an infection and relieving symptoms, but more often than not, the infection would just come right back. Thus, quinine distributed in large numbers definitely helped, but it would not be the complete answer to getting rid of malaria in America. It would take more than medicating the population to get rid of this persistent disease. Once it became known that the mosquito was the cause of malaria, many people believed its death would be the way to eliminate the disease. But killing the adult stage of the mosquito is challenging, since they infest the world in 3D space, and at the time, there wasn't any reliable methods for doing so. Therefore, many believed it was best to attack the mosquito at the most vulnerable point in its life cycle, the larval stage. Mosquitoes lay their eggs in marshy, stagnant water, which then hatch into larvae, which will eventually develop into full-grown, malaria-spreading mosquitoes. And so one way to hit them where it hurts is to eliminate their breeding grounds, the marshy, stagnant water. And unluckily for the mosquitoes, the 1930s brought a wave of public works projects intended to boost the economy, including malaria control and lots of digging. The Works Progress Administration put people to work digging 32,000 miles of ditches and draining 623,000 watered acres. And when draining wasn't possible, coating the surfaces of ponds with oil and spraying their habitat with a compound called Paris Green further smothered the larvae. These efforts coincided with a sharp decline in malaria transmission in the 1930s. But by 1940, while less common than it once was, malaria still persisted. During this time, the US Army still trained its men in many areas of the Southeast US where malaria still had its grip. Not wanting to repeat the hard lessons from the First World War, large-scale anti-malaria operations were undertaken. 40,000 acres of surface water was eliminated, 4.7 million gallons of diesel oil larvicide was used, and $9.8 million was spent on this all-out war against malaria. Then, in 1944, one of the most effective mosquito killers of all time was invented, DDT. Thanks in part to DDT, by 1945, malaria transmission in the US had dropped significantly, and the disease's days in the US were numbered. Then, in 1946, the CDC was born, with the primary mission of finally getting rid of malaria in America once and for all. During the CDC's first few years, more than 6.5 million homes were sprayed with DDT. This, along with even more wetland drainage, pushed the disease out of existence. By 1951, malaria was considered eliminated altogether from the country. The onslaught of DDT, drainage works, habitat oiling, and preventative medication had finally worked. However, there are dozens of other factors which also contributed to malaria's death in America. Some historians firmly believe that the key factor in its eradication was actually population movement away from rural areas, while others think it was simply better education about the disease that did the trick. Others think it was general economic improvement and the installation of screens on houses, and yet others think it was actually a massive drought that led to malaria's demise. This multivariable attack on the disease, and the uncertainty that that causes, has left scientists unsure of how to best translate these results to other parts of the world today. This, along with the fact that many of the approaches taken in America cannot or should not be taken in other parts of the world, has made eliminating malaria globally a massive, still unsolved problem. Most can agree that draining marshy areas in America helped lead to malaria's decline in some amount. However, in Africa, where most of the world's cases of malaria occur today, such methods are not feasible because the mosquitoes there breed in small pools of water that form from rainfall spread across the landscape. It is difficult, if not impossible, to predict when and where the breeding sites will form and to find and treat them before the adult mosquitoes emerge. DDT2 was instrumental in eliminating malaria in America, since it's so effective at killing mosquitoes. The problem is, we now know it's also great at killing everything else. It was banned pretty much everywhere in the world in the 1970s and 80s, and although it's still being used in some places, scientists urge it to be used as a last resort to combat malaria. Distributing anti-malaria medicine also would certainly help if everyone vulnerable to the disease had plentiful access to it. But the cost of this can be prohibitive, and while some progress can be made with this method, the geography of places like Africa make it so even if you make gains in one area, the disease will just pop back up again as it returns from a surrounding area. These problems, along with new drug and insecticide resistance within the parasite and mosquito, makes it so new approaches must be taken in this global battle. Luckily, organizations like the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation are working towards just that, putting their resources in large part towards better data collection along with research and development for creating new medicines and vaccines. And recently, scientists have been experimenting with genetically modified mosquitoes, intended to drastically reduce mosquito populations in the wild. It's a drastic new development in the battle against mosquito-borne illness, and is something we'll cover in depth in a future video. No single strategy to combat malaria will ever be effective everywhere, and unfortunately, there's no silver bullet for this centuries-old problem. But with long-term commitment and a flexible strategy, along with much more funding, it may be possible to eliminate malaria everywhere in the world one day soon. Malaria was in part wiped out in America because of effective military strategy, a strategy that took thousands of man-hours and millions of dollars, and at the time, seemed impossible. There have been many unlikely achievements like this throughout history, from malaria and yellow fever eradication in different parts of the world, to the building of the Panama Canal, to the successful invasion of Normandy on D-Day, all things which took unprecedented levels of coordination and strategy, and all things that easily could have failed with the wrong plans set in motion. You can learn more about the detailed logistics of operations like this in Real Engineering's new Logistics of D-Day series, available exclusively on Nebula, the streaming platform made by the best educational content creators like Wendover Productions, Medlife Crisis, Braincraft, and our other channel Real Engineering. The great thing about Nebula is all of the original content, content that we can create with total freedom, without worrying about the YouTube algorithm or demonetization. The next episode of Real Engineering's Logistics of D-Day series is out today, and an episode of Working Titles will be coming from me early next year, which, if you don't know, is a collaborative series where different YouTube creators break down their favorite TV show intro. Medlife Crisis did an episode on House, Polyphonic did one on Game of Thrones, and I'll be doing one on Westworld. Wendover Productions also just released a 45-minute documentary about one of the world's most remote islands. There is so much original content, with more coming in all the time. And to make it even better, Nebula has partnered with CuriosityStream. CuriosityStream is a streaming platform that has thousands of high-quality and high-budget documentaries, like this series about the spread and effect Ebola has had on Africa and the rest of the world. If you're interested in science topics like this, CuriosityStream has a vast library of topics ranging from physics and nature, but also things like history and economics. And because CuriosityStream loves educational content creators, they are now bundling a subscription to CuriosityStream with a subscription to Nebula, meaning if you sign up using the link below, you'll get access to all of CuriosityStream and all of Nebula for now just $11.99 a year, and be supporting a community of creators that love making new and exciting content. And that is a pretty good deal if you ask me.